introduce a web and iPad-friendly complete electronic health record for a multitude of medical and health specialties. One of the most popular specialties is chiropractic. So Dr. Tony Murray, who's on the phone with us today, offered to do a demo with us and actually show, as a part of the demo, some of the custom templates that he's developed and that he uses in his practice. We'll talk about the company a little bit. We're going to talk about intaking a new patient into your practice, having them complete documentation, sign paperwork, entering new patients into the system. I'll flip it over to Dr. Murray, and he's going to show you how to document a soap note, how to document an exam right on the iPad with a custom form and then sign the note, and then we'll end with some sort of practice management things like uploading other documents, sending referrals from the system, receiving referrals. Dr. Murray is going to spend some time talking about the custom templates, and then we have a whole billing portion of the system.
I'm a chiropractic neurologist. I've been doing chiro-neuro for the last 10 years. I was basically used to a cash-based practice. I worked several years with insurance and worked with a bunch of different EHRs. I was looking for more of the innovative type of EHR that incorporated the iPad and reviewing a bunch of different systems. When I came across DrChrono, it seemed to have everything that I needed when I went out and did my own thing and started a cash-based practice, even though it does insurance as well. My primary thing was cash-based practice. So I'm going to go ahead and work through kind of how I would go through a normal new patient. They have already filled out their basic information and they've maybe done the check-in app. And then so I'm bringing them back. I would just go to my iPad and I would click that start visit to the right. First of all, I can bring up an appointment list and it would show me everybody that's coming, and I could see who's coming in next or what time. Obviously, I clicked on Tom. He's our sample patient that we're going to be using. If I go up to menu and I go up to this additional tab, you're going to see here these custom templates. If I wanted to start with a chiro neuro soap note, this is basically how I would start. After reviewing their initial complaints and that sort of thing, I can question them. I can type in patient's name is a pleasant 35-year-old, complaining of blah, blah, blah. I can either do that real quick here. I can wait till later to actually fill out more details after I've reviewed that and then go on to basically chief complaint. Chief complaint could be neck pain, back pain, sciatica, migraine, TMJ, shoulder. You can customize anything you want. So any of these can be customized to what your normal patient base. So I have extremity type pain. I've got numbness and tingling all the way. I could have a vertigo patient and migraine together. You could have both. You can put multiple things under one. So we'll just say vertigo and neck pain, duration of the complaint. These are all things that I've put in there, which people would normally typically say. How long has it been going on? Okay, 2 weeks. I have it set up percentage of the day. Is it your normal type of things? Visual analog scale, we say it's 7. Whether the pain radiates, I can slide this over. If the patient says yes, radiates, and say where to, obviously just type in right medial border of scap. Aggravating factors, I have all your normal things that you would typically see, whether it be work, sitting, computer, bending, rotation to the right, left, looking up, looking down. A lot of the neuro stuff you're going to have looking up, looking down, looking right. You're going to have turning on your right side for vertigo or any type of movement. So just say turning on the right side makes it get worse and confirm that. If I want to describe the quality of the pain, I can go through sharp, dull, achy, throbbing, shooting, spinning type. So we got a little vertigo, we have spinning, and then it's a dull ache as far as the neck. The way I have them broken down is most people come in with maybe 1, 2, or 3 different chief complaints. If I scroll up here, you're going to see that I have 3 chief complaint options on there. If I have more than that, I have this box here that says other symptoms. So say they have vertigo, neck pain, and I've already filled out those other 2. I can always add a shoulder pain or a TMJ pain to that, and then this one will tend to have some other stuff that isn't on the other list, like maybe medial epicondylitis or intercostal pain, hives, fatigue, lightheadedness, chronic fatigue, anxiety, those troubles thinking. So those are all things that you can add on there as well. You can report how the chief complaint is. Is it getting better? Is it getting worse? It's a new patient. He's seeing us, so it's getting worse. And here I have a subjective box, so I can say vertigo is worse with certain positions. And I can easily just type that in. Relieving factors, ice, heat, resting, the exercises, just your normal things. If we just say lying down, rest, makes it better. So that's all populating. You can say symptoms are worse with morning, afternoon, evening, sleeping, at work, during sex, activity, exercise. Up here you can see there's a body diagram where it says free draw. This is going to bring up an image that I have downloaded into my EHR, basically brought it over to my customized template. And so I have a nice diagram of the person. This patient in particular is complaining of neck pain in this region, and it's radiating into the periscap region. You can draw a circle. I can add text box in here, draw this over, click on that, and I can put vertigo. I can type in there, worse when lying on right side, and I can press done. I can drag it over anywhere I want. If I click out of that, it goes ahead and puts it on there. I can do another text box and put radiating pain. If I want to erase something, I can erase it very easily if you make a mistake or whatnot. You can change the color. If I wanted to do something going down the leg and change the color, I can easily draw this out. Patient's got sciatica going down the right leg, down into the foot. You can zoom in on all these, and you could actually draw, if you wanted to display what toes are affected, and you wanted to draw these, this area of the foot and this area. You can do all different types of drawing and embed that into the note, which is very nice. I know with neuro, we talk a lot about head tilts, angulations of limbs. You can draw whatever you want on there. You can download any form you want. So it can just be a picture of eyes, and you can actually put that in there. I would do vitals as well. The vital page that they have is pretty nice. You have temperature, pulse, blood pressure, respiration, oxygen. You have everything. You can customize vitals to make them whatever you want. They have the O2 height, that sort of thing. So we always want to get our vitals on our patients. So I'm going to go to the next phase of where I would go. So typically I would get the complaints and that sort of thing, and then I would move on to the exam. After I would do the vitals, I'd go to, say, the neuro exam, click on that, and then I'd say start neuro exam. If we did a little mini mental status, I have all the options. Is the patient alert, attentive, able to follow demand? Did we perform a limited mental status exam? Did we do a brief one? What did we do? Did we ask 5 questions, 10 questions? What questions did you ask? Here's some of the common ones. What were they disoriented to? Do they register 3 out of 3? Recall 3 out of 3? Can they recall the Tom and Bill story? Seem to have good or poor memory? So basically, you can put anything you want. Serial 7s, ask the patient, I want you to take this number and subtract 7, and subtract 7 from that. You can do different types of speech, whether they have aphasia, non-aphasia, naming of objects, writing. I mean, you name it, it's in here. Visual, spatial. Can they draw a clock? Do they have difficulty drawing a 12-hour clock? Do they have good visual perception of maps or perception of faces, that sort of thing? So we can go through and say, I did a brief limited mental status exam. The patient was alert, attentive, and able to follow commands. If they're there and I'm not thinking there's much of a cognitive issue, I'm moving on. If I want to add any comments, there's a comment box that I can put anything I want. If I'm checking, I go through cranial nerves. So if I check on that box, I'm looking at cranial nerve 1. Is smell intact? Is it decreased on the right? Is it decreased on the left? They can't identify it. Smell's intact. I'm going on. If I see some observations. Patient has a tremor or something, I can make little notes there. Move into cranial nerve 2. The normal pupil, is it small pupil? Does it react to light? Is it slow to constrict and plastic? Does it fatigue fast? Is it slow to fatigue? I can say it's equal to constriction right to left. So these are very quick. You can use your finger. You can use a little stylus, however you want to do it. I can fly through this thing, no problem. Most of the time, what I'm doing is I'm going to go through. I'm not sitting here doing this as I'm going to knock out the exam, and then as soon as I'm done, I'm going through and knocking this out real quick. The VDA ratios here, right, VDA ratios left, 1-to-1. Did I perform 3, 4, and 6 cranial nerves? Is it normal? If I say no, then I have a box over here. What are the abnormal findings? Okay, say we have ptosis on the left. Cranial nerve 4, we have some vertical diplopia. You can do loss of depth perception, reading, visual scanning problems. If there's any skew deviation, if we did the Halmagyi test, is it normal? Normal head thrust? Normal head thrust to the left, right? Did I see any differences? These are some findings that we may commonly see. Is gait stability intact? Yes or no? If it's not, you're going to say it's not in a certain way. The pursuits, we have abnormal and horizontal, vertical, obliques. You can click within normal limits there. We're going to go down to saccades, where saccades normal to the left, normal to the right. So we say yes. Again, hypermetric, hypometric, latent, slow velocity. Any of these can be customized to your needs. Not everybody's going to work like me. Not everybody wants as little information or as much information. Everybody's a little different, but it's great to start with a nice template, and then you can customize it. And I'm going to show you here shortly, once I go through this, how it actually looks when it prints out. So we say optokinetics, were they normal? What were the quality? Which direction was it decreased? Cranial nerve 5, 6, I have all of these things. Like if I broke down cranial nerve 5, here are all the things that could be wrong. So this is basically a nice reference for me to say what's going on. Here's cranial nerve 7. Here are all the possible things that I may see. And it has the grading scale, which you're familiar with, hypomnemia, grade 1, decreased blinking, grade 2, decreased blinking, mouth open sometimes. So I have those things in here to make things easy on myself so I can fly through this. Cranial nerve 8, we're going to do Wyme. So on this patient, we tested and have positional vertigo. We'll go through, say all the other ones are normal. We'll say no for that one. Biceps have all the deep tendon reflexes. If you go through and you feel there's some differences, if they're all normal, I also have a quick checkbox within normal limits. We'll just go through, do a couple, 2 on the right, 1 on the left. This plus lower extremity, 2 plus. Can they heel walk, toe walk? Yes. You can. I have a box that just says motor testing within normal limit, upper and lower extremity. Yes. On this patient, was the sensation within normal limits? If not, I have a diminished dermatome. Where was the diminished sensation? You can also draw that on the other page. Gait and balance, was it normal? Quality of gait, do I have reduced hip extension, reduced right arm swing, a wide base gait, circumduction type gait? Is there a lateral propulsion type gait, steppage, shuffling gait? So we have all those options, which makes it a really, really, really cool note at the end of the day. Let me just do a couple of these. Just say decreased, reduced right arm strength, lateral pulsion to the right. You can go in and say, did dual tasking improve the gait? Okay, dual task and improve the sway. Did they sway more left with eyes open? To the right, eyes open, right, eyes closed. Go through rapid alternating movement, heel toe sway quality, Fukuda step test, supination, pronation. So I have all these different tests that we do in neurology, the path pointing finger to nose. If we go in and do the finger tap test, I have it whether it's decreased on the left, decrease on the right, whether it's grade 1, 2, or 3, or 4. And so we go through and we have that for each one of our tests that we do in functional neurology. Babinski, down going toes bilaterally, extension of grade toe, clonus. I also have a comments box down here on the bottom. Abnormal findings. If I didn't hit something that was up top, and I wanted to just do a quick repeat, and I saw, okay, patient tested positive for torsional upbeat nystagmus, so we're going to go ahead and do that. press confirm. Then I'm going to move on. I would do like a normal orthopedic evaluation. I'm not going to go through that, but you test your orthopedic test, ranges of motion, that sort of thing. I'll have all that. I have an orthopedic template that I have for that. If I go through and I do a spinal palpation, okay, patient had neck pain, upper and mid cervical region, rib cage. I have all your possibilities of any spinal type stuff, hip, groin. If I'm looking at different muscle groups, cervical paraspinal muscle spasm, and then we go down, you have the shoulder, all the shoulder muscles, extensor muscles, pain with traveling in the medial border of the scap, there's subluxation, what are the different things, inflammation, myofascial pain, trigger point, sensory cutaneous nerves are inflamed. We're going to go through, there's decreased range of motion, hypertonicity, and then joint mobility issues, posture analysis, you can go through and talk about yaw, pitch, roll, high shoulders, anterior, pelvic tilt, scapular winging, A to P sway, lateral sway, low parameter distribution of weakness. All those things can be put on your SOAP note. I got functional movement, functional assessment. What did I do? Did I adjust them? Upper cervical, mid cervical, low cervical. I don't typically say I adjusted C1. I have it broken down to CO, occiput, C2. But you can put all C1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 individually and just click on which ones you did and whether the technique you use. You can add all that in there. I have the upper extremity manipulations that I like to do, the lower extremity manips that I do, therapeutic exercises, which most of these are familiar to what I do in the FNOR, and if they're not in here, I like to use the EREPS program. With this patient, obviously, I'm not going to be doing this. I'm probably going to be doing repositioning type maneuver. I just wanted to show you kind of some of the things that I like to do. You can see the glute FNOR circuit training, iso clamps with resistance, iso the glute bridge marching, sideline hip abduction. So I have all these already in here, so I can flip through real quick and just hit what I'm doing. So let me just put a few just to show you what it's going to look like on the note. And then say neuromuscular reeducation. If I was going to do, just say, Eric's balance pad, did some cerebellar exercises, targeting, utilizing finger. And then if I go down to neuro, I did gait stability exercises. I did some no-nos or yes-yeses, did pursuits, saccades, OPKs, complex motor activity. With this patient, I'm probably going to do an epley to the right, or I'm going to look at what canals involved if I'm doing a barbecue roll, modified epley. So just say we did that. If we did any type of modalities, I have those in here, electric muscle stem, rebuilder for neuropathy, those type of things, where I did it. So you just click on that, literally. So just say we did E-stem on the cervical spine. So we put that in there. And then say we did some heat. And then basically assessment, just say today's the initial visit. You can say patient appears to have canal lithiasis of right posterior canal. You can say BPPV or whatever. Treatment plan. I'm going to treat them today and then I'm going to see them back tomorrow most likely. So initially, what are my goals? I'm going to decrease pain, inflammation, increase activity tolerance. You can put whatever you want in that treatment schedule. I'm going to have a follow-up tomorrow, so that's going to be scheduled for tomorrow. I have all your normal 3 times a week for 4 weeks, 3 times for 3. So I have these so they're easy for me. If they're PRN or plan to schedule a reeval in next week, 2 weeks, 4 weeks, I can do that. Response to treatment, how they felt dizzy, they felt soreness, lightheaded, headache, feels better, increased mobility, less pain. I have that in there. Plan comments. If you have any special plan, like you want to send them out for a MRI or that sort of thing, you can easily refer a patient, recommending they go so-and-so. Here are my general billing things. I like to put, there's a billing page, and I'll show you that as well, but I like to sometimes include what I did and just say if I did like canal repositioning, just say adjusted, whatever. So that goes on there. If I go and I say view note, so you go to view note, but it's basically going to document what we just put on those. You put the neuro exam first. Typically, I would have it would start here at subjective, objective assessment plan, and then the neuro exam will go at the bottom. The neuro exam typically would be after this area, so subjective. You could put whatever his chief complaint is. Todd is a 35-year-old male that presents with positional vertigo, started, and then you can see that everything that I did is already in paragraph form, easy to read. It tells the insurance company or even the patient if they request your records. It's all laid out for them. The only thing that you're not seeing on here is the billing, and I can show you that pretty easily. But if you look at the neuro, this is how it lays it out, nice and detail-oriented, easy to read. If anybody ever, this patient was leaving or being referred, you can easily refer this file over to them and they can read it and they'll be super impressed. Can I just do the billing thing real quick? So if I went here, so the way I did that is just, you just go to billing. And if I wanted to do a CPT code, and I just did 99203, so I can easily, right here from my iPad, put that in, and then I'm going to, your price would already be in there, and then I'm going to put a modifier 25. Say we did 98940, MNIP for one of two regions, you're going to have your price in there already, and then say a 995 repositioning. There it is. So we did a cantilever repositioning. You're going to go through and put a fee schedule in there, so those will all be on there. We're going to go to the ICD-10s. What's really cool about this, you literally just type in what it is, and it's going to find it for you. So say we have cervicalgia. So say we did this, and then say we have somatic subluxation or dysfunction, whatever you want to put, vertigo. So we've got central origin, the right ear. So we're going to put vertigo, the right ear.
Touch on the pick list, too. I mean, we don't have it set up on your account to show the audience. If you touch on pick list on the right, that's where your preferred diagnosis codes will be listed, the diagnosis that you see most often. So instead of searching for them, you can also set them up and just touch them, like a custom list there. And the same thing goes for the CPT codes, and you can have them saved to include your modifiers and fees as a result of uploading a fee schedule.
And that's the way, if like an auto patient is typically getting neuromuscular rehab and therapeutic exercises with E-stim and heat, then you can have those right there available to you. And most of those are going to have the 59 modifier, and then they're already in there and easily to select. But so again, if I go back to view complete note after I put the diagnosis in the C's in, you're going to see that it shows up on your assessment, has your diagnoses here, and then under your plan, it's going to have what you did, where it says sign and lock up top on the right. And then if I scroll down now, you're going to see at the end of the note that it was e-signed by Kyle at 4:50, 7:20. And you can see the drawings there. From here, you can literally, if you wanted to fax this or print it, you can do that if you want.
Do you know how to get to the Super Bill on the iPad?
Yeah. So what I would do is I would click the menu box, and then I'd click the home button. Let me just say appointment status is complete, billing status paid in full. I would say credit card, and then, you know, go to Superville. Generally, it pops right up, and you can either email or what I do is I put it on their on patient so they have access directly to their Superville. I don't have to print or send anything to them. I literally put send to on patient, and they have an app on their phone called on patient, and they can literally download it or send it in to their insurance if they want to try to get reimbursement. I mean, it's cool to see the Super Bill just because the Super Bill already has your office, tax ID number, address, everything the insurance would ever need to submit a Super Bill or for out-of-network benefits or any of that stuff. It's literally the click of a button.
I'll just bring it up on the website. You can see it on the iPad, too, what the Super Bill looks like.
I have my logo and branding on that and that sort of thing.
My name's Kyle Morham, and I'm a senior product specialist with DrChrono, electronic health records. Our company is actually based in Mountain View, California, right in the heart of Silicon Valley. And so this is a little bit of a history just on DrChrono. We were founded in 2009. The big innovation that we had was writing a iPad native electronic health record in 2010 when the first version of the iPad came out. And so we've kept that app up to date. We literally make a release like once a month, if not once every 6 weeks. We've been ranked 3 years in a row as the number one overall iPad-based EHR, and then we're a fast-growing company. When somebody like Dr. Murray joined us a couple of years ago, we probably had about 1,000 customers. Today, we have 7,000 customers, and they're in all 50 states around the U.S., so literally from Alaska to Hawaii to Florida to New York to Texas, we have a paying customer in every state and some abroad. Just to look at products kind of as a primer, we're going to go through a live software demo in a minute here, but just to kind of give you guys an overview on what the product does, it's a complete scheduling application. We'll talk about the customization that's available within the scheduling, things like appointment profiles, reminder profiles, how the calendar works. Just a couple of sort of high level sort of selling points on DrChrono, why customers like us and what makes customers a good fit for DrChrono. Not all customers are a good fit, but customers or doctors that are looking for customized workflow, not a general practice internal medicine doctor, or you're not your sort of run-of-the-mill chiropractor, you're doing some type of special adjustment or doing a different kind of technique, our workflow customization and template builder allows you to document essentially any type of visit, the way you think about that visit and the way you think about that documentation. Customers that are looking for a completely cloud-based solution, something where it can be accessed on the iPad or any internet-connected computer. Customers that want an install version, that they want to own their software, that's not a good fit for us. We want customers that are forward-thinking and use mobile devices, that type of thing. We provide unlimited support to all of our paid customers, and we do offer to train you guys at no cost. We can import the data from another system. All we need is an Excel file or a .csv file exported from your prior scheduling software, EHR, and we'll do a bulk import directly into the DrChrono system for you. And this is what the workflow looks like in terms of how we onboard a new client. So we can look at this slide again at the end of the presentation, but essentially we do a kickoff call, and then there's a series of trainings that are going to train you, and if you have staff, like a front desk staff, or maybe you do bill insurance and you have a biller, we'll train everybody on the system, and after the system's been customized, we'll train them on that customized install. So just to get going here with the actual software demo, I'm going to show you how to log into DrChrono on the website. And it's worth pointing out that we're going to be switching back and forth between using the website and using the iPad as we go through this demo at DrChrono. Okay, so the information kind of syncs. It's everywhere. It's on the website and it's on the iPad at the same time. I'll sort of cue you guys as the audience as to what I'm looking at the moment. So when you see my big web browser on the screen, when you see either me or Dr. Murray have a smaller screen like this in front of us, we're on the iPad. We're just going to log into the website to get going. It's really simple. You dial up our web address, drchrono.com, just if you want to look at our webpage. Look here if you're interested in reading more about our software before contacting us. There's just a ton of information that's available here for you guys. You can read all about our company here, read about the different services and software packages that we offer for doctors or chiropractors. And then you can also look at some of the plan types. So I'm going to go ahead and click the login button from the homepage, and I'm going to enter in my username and password and click login. And when I do this on the web, it locks me right into the clinic schedule. So this is the place where all your patient appointments are going to be scheduled. You're going to look at this schedule like as you would a normal online scheduler. You can look at it monthly. You can take a weekly view of the schedule. If you've got multiple chiropractors or multiple doctors, even of different specialties in your clinic, you can view those schedules side by side on a daily basis. You can also look at an exam room view. So you have different areas of your clinic. Maybe there's a rehab area. Maybe there's a couple of adjusting tables. Maybe there's a private exam room with a door on it. You guys can customize that setup within the schedule. So you can add as many columns here as you would like. Actually, the limit's 15, but up to 15 exam rooms. And you can title those exam rooms however you'd like. So So if you'd like to make a waiting room in exam one, a therapy area, maybe massage room in exam three, that's fine. This is just my demo account, but you guys can change that as you see fit. For the purpose of this demo, I'm going to schedule a new patient appointment on the calendar, and I'm actually going to add a patient to the schedule at the same time as adding them to the calendar, adding them to my database in the calendar at the same time. So I'm just going to use my mouse on any computer. It can be a Mac or a PC, it doesn't matter. I'm on the web right now, where the only compatibility you need to think about is the browser that you use. So you can use Safari, you can use Google Chrome, or you can use Mozilla Firefox. So any of those three web browsers will run our website really well. And this is going to be a brand new patient that I've never seen before. So from the schedule appointment box, I'm going to select new patient. And then right here, I'm going to type in the patient's name. And I can add a cell phone number if I'd like, or email address, or both. It's not required. And I'm going to go ahead and hit add. So you can see I've successfully added this patient to my account, and now I want to confirm an appointment with him. So you can see I've already clicked on the 5:15 appointment type, and by default my appointment length is set to 15 minutes. But in my account, what I've done is I've set up some kind of custom appointment profile. So I'll just show you an example, and maybe I'll ask Dr. Murray to talk about this as well in a minute and tell me some of the different appointment profiles that he set up. But in my system, I just set up these various different types of appointments. In chiropractic, typically there's a new patient evaluation and then follow-up adjustment. But now, Dr. Murray, what are some of the appointment profiles that you created in your account?
So I'll have like a new chiro office visit. I'll have a chiro follow-up visit. I'll have a chiro neuro new exam. I'll have a chiro neuro follow-up. Also, if I have a personal injury or auto type accident, then I will do, I have another profile that just basically says new auto patient or auto follow-up visit. So I've kind of tailored them to, you know, based on whatever they're coming for, or like an FNOR type patient, they may have a different profile depending on, you know, the time frame, because you can set those parameters for how long you're spending, like a new neuro exams, you know, an hour versus maybe a chiro exams, like half hour, and vice versa with the normal chiro follow-up versus a chiro neuro follow-up, maybe time-wise a little different.
Yeah, perfect. So thanks for that detail. So the screen that I'm in right now is where a doctor like Dr. Murray would come to set those different types of appointments. So this is actually the management screen. So in Dr. Murray's account, he would have come to this custom appointment profile screen, selected add new profile, and then created his list that he just spoke about. And attached to that list, you can associate different types of attributes to that appointment type in the system. So some of the different examples of those attributes are, you know, what's the name of the appointment? How does that appointment display on your clinic schedule in terms of a color? You can choose any color you'd like. What's the default duration of that particular appointment type? Like maybe a new patient is a longer appointment than a follow-up patient. And then do you want that appointment type available on your website for online scheduling? And finally, what types of consent forms do you want to associate with that appointment type? Okay, there's some other things here as well, like associating a certain type of payment profile. So, you know, Dr. Murray may see some workers' comp type patient appointments, and so he might want to categorize that as a workers' comp visit. He might also see some appointment types which are cash only, and so he might want to put that as a cash payment profile or insurance payment profile. We won't focus on this, but we do have the capability to completely bill workers' comp, auto accident, as well as insurance claims, both in-network and out-of-network through our system. So if you guys are interested in that, that's something we can cover at another time. But you can link all of those attributes together with appointment profiles. Okay. really good. So just that was the setup screen. Going back to the schedule really quick for our example, we've got our patient here, so we would have selected an example appointment profile to change the information on that. So you can see here the duration's automatically changed to 30 minutes, and I've got a green color on my appointment screen. Now down here, this is a consent form that's going to be associated with this patient. If I want to remove that consent form on a one-time basis, or if I want to add another consent form on a one-time basis, I do have the capability to do that. And then at the bottom, before I confirm the appointment, I can choose what type of reminder profile the patient will receive so that they are on time to the appointment and they show up, you know, in the first place. So the system will automatically send text, phone, and email reminders to the patient. So your front desk staff, or if you're a micro practice and you don't have any staff, you don't have to spend time, you know, giving your patients reminders in advance. The system will just do that automatically. So that's kind of a cool feature as well. And just like the appointment profile drop-down list, these reminder profiles are also customizable, so you guys can build your own set or sequence of reminders and use whatever style of reminders you would like to get set up in the system. One of the cool things, too, just before I leave scheduling, if you do have front desk staff, this little note section is a fantastic place to have your front desk staff write any notes to you as the doctor or any of the practitioners in your practice as to what's going on with the patient. So might just say, you know, this is a new patient coming for a neuro exam. Or you can say this patient doesn't have insurance. Any note your front desk staff can write in there. It's not going to be part of the patient chart. Just going to show up on the doctor's iPad when the doctor is ready to see the patient. So that is the appointment scheduling on the system, okay, for a new patient. Now, if it's an existing patient, the flow is basically the same. You just click on the schedule, and instead of clicking new patient, you're just going to look the patient up. So I've got a patient, Michael. I'll just begin to type in Michael, and then I can find their right patient. I can also look by last name, so if I want to find Smith, or and just now drill down to Dan, I can confirm this date of birth is correct, and I can select that patient, and then the rest of the appointment setting process is the same. Now you can see this is an existing patient on my account. I've got a statement balance here, so this is typically if you're collecting insurance, if you're cash, it's going to be zero. Got an appointment counter. I've also got a flag telling me I might be missing some information on this patient. And I've added some custom flags here. This feature is actually going to be available on our special offer. And I can create any custom flag I want, like only accept cash from this patient, their checks bounce, or you know, whatever you know the flag is, you can add as many custom flags to the system as you'd like. You can pull reports on these custom flags and things of that nature. So a couple of just nuances and differences there about follow-up or recurring existing patients in the system. Excellent. So that is the scheduling portion of the system. Now, you know, the patient, it might be a few days between the time that you schedule an appointment and the patient comes in. By the way, the system works really well for walk-ins as well. That's something, again, if we're not going to cover it today, but if you're interested, let us know. I'll show you there's a special flow for walk-ins, and it doesn't require any of that calendar scheduling in advance. You can just drop the patient appointment right onto the iPad and start the note without any of that process that I just went through. It's a nice shortcut for those chiropractors that have a lot of walk-ins. Okay, so a few days pass, and the patient arrives in the clinic for their first visit. So typically what happens in a traditional practice is upon greeting the patient, the front desk staff or the doctor will hand the patient a clipboard with a bunch of paper intake forms on it. With the DrChrono system, we have a much more modern approach. So on your iPad or on one of the iPads in the practice, we will be running this check-in application. And instead of handing handing a paper form to the patient, what we'll do is we'll hand an electronic intake form. The check-in app on the iPad. Okay, so to do that, when the patient walks into your office, simply touch the check-in application, and once you do that, you'll see the landing screen on the check-in application. So you'll see all of the patients that are scheduled in your clinic for the day. So these are the patients that I had on my clinic's schedule, and this is the patient that we added as a demo patient for the new patient. So I'm going to go ahead and just touch that patient with my finger on the iPad, and I'll use my mouse to point where my finger is because you can't see my finger. But I'm just going to touch right there with my finger on the iPad, and you'll see on the iPad that that appointment note that I wrote as the front desk person has displayed itself on the iPad. It's available in real time. So one of the cool things that drChrono allows you to do for your new patients is actually use the iPad to take a profile photo of that patient. You don't need to have a webcam, or you don't need to have a separate camera. You can actually activate the camera through the iPad. So I'll just do it right here, and I'll take a picture of myself. I'll just turn the iPad around. Okay, so now I took sort of a selfie, but you get the idea. You can take the picture of the patient, frame it up correctly, and now you have a photograph of all of your patients. It's completely HIPAA compliant. It's not stored on the iPad's camera roll. It's stored on our secure server along with all the rest of your clinic notes and protected health information. So now that you've got the profile photo, you're ready to proceed with the rest of the check-in process. And at this point, you can actually just hand the iPad to the patient. And we've got a really simple, clean design in terms of a UI right here. And the patient can actually just fill out all of this information on their own. And when they're done, you can take the iPad back from them. And all of their data that they put typically right on a paper form is already going to be electronic in your health record. So you don't need to scan anything, you don't need to keep paper copies of anything for any reason, you can just throw all those pieces of paper away. And during the implementation process, what we'll do with working with you is to take a look at all of those documents that you have right now and understand the information that you've been collecting. And then we can use that to customize these screens and collect the exact same pieces of information that you were collecting before, so that you're not giving anything up by moving to the iPad check-in process. And I think Dr. Murray, you can attest to the fact that we've helped you customize, like as an example, this reason for visit form, like in your personal account, which we're not showing because you've got live patient data in there. You've got custom intake forms here, right?
Yeah, I have a custom intake form for my, normal patient visit. And then obviously, if it's an auto type visit, those questions are a little different, or slip and fall or that sort of thing. So I have those, they're available electronic, so the patient can actually go through and fill that out directly in the system.
Yeah. Exactly. So, again, it's pretty easy. We can customize all these forms. We've got also a library of pre-built forms as well as forms that Dr. Murray is making available from his account. So you guys have a lot of resources at your disposal. And if you want to customize that stuff further, it's pretty easy to do so at the end. So once the patient's filled out their own information, the final step before answering any final questions is for the patient to review any type of documentation that you have. This is just an uploaded PDF form, so if you want to put your practice logo on some of these forms, that's just fine. They'll touch this orange button that says read and consent, and then they'll be given a signature box that they'll use their finger or a stylus to sign their name. Okay, so that's done, and now that form is uploaded, and the patient check-in is complete.